Senhor, to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Isn't it good to be reminded about what worship is all about? There's a lot of things we can worship, a lot of things we can put our hope and our trust in, but they inevitably let us down. They inevitably leave our hearts longing for more. But I'm so glad that we have a God who knows us and who receives our worship. Didn't we have a good service to the Lord last week? I pray that was a blessing to your heart this week. I know I received strength from it all week long. I'm a little hungry today. I'm ready for a little bit more. Somebody said last week the dinner table was set last week. And it was ready for us, and so many partook, and I'm so glad of that. But I believe God, He still has something for us today. And I believe He receives our worship today. This is a day that He set apart that we can be together. There's a covenant between us and God, and a lot of those covenant things have been passed away in the new covenant. But the Sabbath is something He always gave us, that we could be together and celebrate what should be true every day of our lives, that we are with God and God is with us. So, praise God that you are here today in the midst of this rainy, cold weather. I thank God for heat. I thank God for a non-leaky roof. I thank God for comfortable seating. I thank God that we're big enough that we can all get together. Yeah, those are simple things, but I've been in churches where none of those things were true. I've been in churches, even in secondary countries, where there was not even a back to your seat. But it's a place of worship. That's what it's all about. It's about a place of worship and giving that to Him. Thank you for being here today. Welcome. And I do want to tell you, before we get into church, a lot of you, in fact, all of you should have been handed a slip of paper. We are talking about, as a board, starting back Sunday school. We haven't had Sunday school since March of 2020. That's hard to wrap my brain around. It's just been that long because of the circumstances. Unfortunately, I had more texts yesterday than more people I knew have come in contact and contracted it. So unfortunately, we're still there. We're not quite over it all, and we're still struggling to get through it. But we did know, we thought we may have an opportunity here to perhaps do it on Sunday evenings. A Sunday evening would enable us in service to spread out from each other. We're in our small classes that we couldn't. So just wanted to poll, the board wanted to poll the congregation about your interest in that. Coming at like 4 or 5 o'clock, I believe I put on your sheet there, and seeing if you want to all come. Of course, there'd be children's ministry too, as divided as we can make it. But you'd be able to sit with your group as close as you can, but still have just one class for everybody. So at least that gets us back to Sunday school time. Not the only idea we can have, but we just want to do what we can to minister to the congregation. And we know we've had services continually, thank God. We've continued to have services, but I know there's a lot of longing for people to get back to our Sunday school time where we're learning from the Word of God. So just wanted to give you an opportunity, if you'll fill those out during the service, and when you put in your offering right at the end of the service, as you're leaving, just deposit those in there. We'll gather those and we'll pull those, and I'll let you know later. Also, the other announcement that I have today is we were planning next week to start a brand new series, Christian Atheist, but the Lord had other plans. So that is now scheduled for 2 weeks away, and if the Lord has other plans, well, we can still push it on back because we're on His timetable. We're on His agenda, and what He wants matters. But I am excited about what the Lord is already laying out for this year. A lot of things that the pastors in the church are working on, both for the adults and the youth. And I think it's going to be a good year. In spite of everything that's going on, I believe it's going to be a good year in the Lord. Because my year in the Lord is not dependent on my circumstances. It's dependent on His faithfulness. And I see a whole lot of people in this church that can testify to the faithfulness of God. He is enough for COVID. Amen? He's enough for whatever you're going to face. Oh, come on. I'm not hearing you this morning. He's enough for whatever you're going to face. He's enough for surgeries coming up. He's enough if cancer is in your future. He's enough if your job is not what it's going to be in the future. God is enough for whatever you're facing. So let's stand and let's give Him worship today. Almighty God, we come into this house, a house that has been dedicated for the church to assemble and to say, God, You are our God. You are not the God of the world. You are not the God of these people over here. You are my God. I worship You. I give my life to You because You gave Your life for me. You loved us first. So out of that gift, out of, hallelujah, out of that blessing, out of that transforming power, now, God, we have the opportunity to look back at our Creator, our Savior, our God, and say, I love You. We are not shackled by sin. We are not darkened by guilt. We are not held down by the evil of this world. God, we have been set free, and with these free lips, with these free hands, with this free heart, God, I choose, and we choose to worship and adore the name that's above all other names, the name of our Savior, our Healer, our Redeemer, our Friend, our Companion, our God. Blessed be the name of God here this day. Thank You, Lord, that You are with Your people. So, God, I anticipate as we enter into an atmosphere of communion where we're going to talk to You and we're opening our hearts that You may talk back to us, that, God, something's going to transpire in this time. Something's going to happen between us and God. And, Lord, I just don't want to see it, though, God, I do want to see it in others. Because, God, I'm not a watcher. I'm not someone who's just here to see what I can see. But God, I am here to receive. I am here to interact with You. So God, I pray every heart will do just that. So Father, whether we need to pray from now to the end, whether we praise, whether we hear the Word, whatever we do, God, Your will be done. God, Your way and Your power be exercised in Your people's lives. You love us. Oh God, You love us. So, Father, let that love be spread and let love come from Your creation back to You. And this is a good service, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God. Praise the Lord and all God good to us. I was thinking about when the pastor talking about the things he's thankful for. And I said, thank God for another day of mercy.
Yes.
Thank God for another day of mercy. Amen. An old song says, are you washed in the blood or have you been to Jesus? Let's sing that this morning. As we bring honor to Him this morning. Have you been to Jesus for that cleansing fire? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His strength? If we are not, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Yeah.
You may not know it, I don't know. Let's sing together. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter. And he says,
I may have to walk through it, but I intend to come out on the other side. I intend to testify to the faithfulness of the Lord by walking out, not by sheer will, because if I could do it, I don't need Him. But the Lord, He is my shepherd. He's led me through many. He's led you through many. So thanks be to God for His faithfulness to each and every one of us. As we go to the Lord in prayer, let's take some battle lines that have been drawn to the Lord. Because we got needs, we got issues, but I think that needs are just miracles that are about to happen. Because as I read the New Testament, there were a lot of needs until Jesus came. Then when Jesus came, there was a testimony. I see, maybe that's where some people get a wrong idea. God doesn't touch me to make me feel better. He touches me to glorify His name. He is God. So He is not here to pamper us. He is here to use us to testify to His glory. I'm all in. I want to testify to His glory. What needs do you want to bring into the knowledge of the congregation? Just go ahead and stand, church. We need to worship the Lord here today. We need to thank Him already for what He's done. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We don't see it, but we already believe it. We don't know everything, dear God, but we believe it's happening even now. My God, bless your name. Hallelujah.
Yonder.
now while we're going through this crisis. I was wondering this week, Pastor, I said, I hadn't even witnessed anybody. I hadn't led anyone to the Lord in for a whole year, it looks like. But you approach people that don't want it, they don't want to hear that. Stay away. I said, why? Scripture teaches in Proverbs that one that wins souls to the Lord is wise. I want to be wise, I guess. And he said, now's the time to witness to my body, people in the Lord, so we can see each other here, okay? We can speak to each other. We can't hug each other like we used to or like we desire to. Now's the time to minister to the people that you can't see, you can't touch, your brothers and sisters in Christ. That makes sense?
Sir.
Because we're hurting too. We're hurting too. I got a big family, but I want them all to go to heaven. There's plenty of room there for them. But you know, you can't break the neck, twist the arm, or whatever, make them go.
It has been a blessing in these weeks to hear from the Word of God, but not to hear it from my own lips, but to hear it from the different families in this church. I think the Word of God is powerful, and I think it's a testimony to the power of God at work in each and every family. Now if you think I'm going to stop, no. I appreciate everyone who is willing and able to do it, because I think we need the Word of God more than ever. I think we need it. We don't need it just read to us. We need to hear it from our own lips, us saying it, us speaking it, us believing it. So today the Ellenberg clan started with Ellenbergs. It's kind of branched further and further out. I don't want to ask them to come. I'm going to move way back, as many other families, I can't stand right behind them. I can stand way back. They're going to fill all around here. But I am just so excited. So many are walking up toward this platform. Hey. Please stand for the reading of the Word of God.
Do them like But now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old evil nature and all its wicked deeds. In its place, you have clothed yourselves with a brand new nature that is continually being renewed as you learn more and more about Christ, who created this new nature within you.
In this new life, it doesn't matter if you are a Jew or a Gentile, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbaric, uncivilized, slave or free. Christ is all that matters, and He lives in all of us. Since God chose you to be the holy people whom He loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. You must make allowance for each other's faults and forgive the person who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. And the most important piece of clothing you must wear is love. Love is what binds us all together in perfect harmony.
And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are all called to live in peace and always be thankful. Let the words of Christ in all their richness live in your hearts and make you wise. Use His words to teach and counsel each other. Sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And whatever you do or say, let it be a representative of the Lord Jesus, all while giving thanks to Him through God the Father.
I thank the Lord. All my family's here except Tommy, and he had to work. I'll pray for the ones that didn't get up here.
You may be seated, yes. This week and next week are kind of, Lord being willing, kind of coordinated. It's going to be the opposite, but the Lord has His own plans, and I'm okay with that. Only people who don't know how God works are scared by what He does, and we've all been there. We've all been scared when God pushes us out of our comfort zones, but when we see that He's able to help us when we're uncomfortable, then we learn to trust Him a little better. When we're all under control, we got it under control, we can't trust Him. When we have nothing else to trust in, we trust Him. But I've been talking about, since in this new year, we celebrate a new year, and thank God it is here. But I think it's more important that we celebrate a new you. Because life goes on. As Solomon said long ago, there is nothing new under the sun. Technology has changed, culture has changed, a lot of things have changed, but people are still just people. They have the same longings and the same weaknesses that they've always had. But I can tell you, though we have started out like everybody else in this world and have issues concerning that, we have someone that's on our side. And Paul speaks to that in this chapter. He says, you know, we've come from all different places. We're barbarians, we're free, we're slaves, we're Jews, we're Gentiles. We come from all different places, all types of circumstances. But there is a God who cares about us. He doesn't want a Gentile church and a Jewish church. He just wants a church. He doesn't want some people following Him this way and some people following Him this way. He wants all people to follow Him and to depend on Him for everything in their life. And He starts this chapter by saying something beautiful about our condition. See, this chapter is not, you see a lot of it, most of the time we look at scriptures, we see all the, you should do this, you should do that, and yes, this is about what God is doing. But it's because of what He's done that He tells us what we ought to do going forward. He says, since you've been raised with Christ, something happened to you, something happened to me because of Jesus Christ. Our life was changed forever. Our destiny, our transactions in life, they were changed forever because we've been raised with Christ. You can look throughout this chapter. It also says we've been hidden in Christ in God. We're hidden. That doesn't mean God's not looking at us, but God's seeing us like He looks at His Son. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't deserve that. I haven't earned that. I'm not good In and of my own flesh, I am not good. God already knows that. It's not a surprise to Him. But He says, I've hidden you in my Son.
Right.
So when I see you, I see my Son. That is our standing before God. It's being lifted out from where we belong to a place where He desires for us to be. And the life that we are to live is to reflect that. It says that one day, as we sang, that His glory is going to be revealed, Brother Jimmy.
Yes, yes, yes.
I don't know what's going on that day. I don't know what Fox News has got planned or CNN got planned. But when Jesus splits the eastern sky, all plans are off. And He takes center stage. And we can say, yeah, I was right. But that's not what that day is about. It says, when He is revealed in His glory, you will share that glory. You see, God doesn't have to say, okay, I'm going to finally show up so you'll finally see who I am. God's not threatened. God's not worried. God's not concerned. We are in turmoil. God sits in perfect peace. Everything is under control. So when He is revealed in glory, He says, I want you to see those who trusted. I want you to see those who endured. I want you to see those who had faith. I want you to see that my glory is now their glory as well. All those things have been given to us by Christ's sacrifice, being raised from the dead. We have new life, truly new life in Him. But I want you to see in chapter 3, it says we've been raised with Christ. Where is He? Where is Jesus? It says right there in the first chapter, first verse. He's at the right hand of the Father. So Jesus is residing in heaven. Right hand of the Father. And you notice Paul says, so if Jesus is there and all my status and standing is with Him, where should my mind be? Where should my heart be? Where should my character be? Where should my ideas be? Where should my desires be? He says I should set my affection, set my desires, set my mind on things above. It's kind of like this picture that I have for you here. He's got a great big hand that's got it all under control. But He's inviting us to think a little more heavenly and a lot less earthly. You understand, we're of earth. We know how the earth is. We know how it gets. As Brother Steve hearkened earlier, when left to ourselves, we get pretty filthy, don't we?
Right, right.
When there were guards up, people behaved because the guards were up. When society frowned on you, when the pressure was there, people behaved themselves. Do you think for a moment they didn't do it in the privacy of their own little lives? Do you think they made up all these words they use now? Do you think they started acting in a way that nobody's ever acted before? Of course not. They just acted like they wanted to, and they continue to do that. And guess what? How you can describe that? It's filthy. It's earthly. It's common. It's down to the absolute lowest level, and the dirt's not low enough. You've got to get into the mud. You've got to get into the sewer, and then you've got to see how filthy can we go. Dare me to be wrong. Because I haven't seen it yet. That is the mantra. Let's see how filthy, how common, how earthly we can really be. And unfortunately, we've had people behind the pulpit of God try to play that game. We've had Christians that say, okay, it doesn't matter what I do, so I can be filthy and still be covered by the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's not what Paul said. Paul said, since you've been raised with Christ, why would you ever act filthy again? Since you've been raised with Christ, why do you act like the world? Why do you blend in? Why don't you set your affections on heavenly things? That word heavenly, we use that a lot, don't we? Me and my girls, we always love it. What is that commercial, that chocolate commercial where that girl's taking 5 minutes to eat a piece of chocolate that big? It's heavenly. Well, we've said that a lot of things. Oh, that's just a heavenly meal. Oh, that's a heavenly smell. That was a heavenly experience. It's amazing how many of those things are simply sensory things. We're thinking, what is the best that there can be that I can experience? And so that's heaven. So we call that thing heavenly. And there's nothing wrong with that, because heavenly includes those things. But when Paul describes, since we've been raised with Christ, let's set our mind on things above, he goes through this chapter saying, here's how heaven works. And you know what? It's not about meals. It's not about fragrances. It's not about experiences. It's about character. It's about our heart. It's about how we live. It's about how we interact. It's about how we have determined, this is who I'm going to be. So I want to share with you just four simple things that are heavenly, that God desires for us to live like. Because otherwise, Brother T.B., otherwise, we're going to live dirty. Now this, you may recognize underneath all that gunk, that's Mike Rowe. Who had the show Dirty Jobs. Some of you may have seen that. Dirty Jobs showing in America the stuff that gets done that you and I probably don't do. And that's kind of the American, and that's just kind of a human way. Whatever it takes to get it done, get it done. Get down in it, take care of it. And I thank God for those people that do that. I thank God for that mindset, because I don't want to clean out sewers, so do you? I don't want to do that. I don't want to do all the ugly things, the dirty things that have to be done. I love hamburgers as much as anybody, but I don't want to slaughter that cow. Just talking about it, that's all I am. So that is kind of a mindset. Do what it takes to get it done. And that's good on one level. But then when we think of spiritual level, why would we do what the world does to get the job of God done? We can't do that. He says, set your mind on heavenly things. You see, that's the problem that Jesus had with his disciples. When they all came together, Christ had his Father's will in mind. So he was focused. He was goal-oriented. He didn't do it like the earthly people would do it. He didn't try to be a Pharisee. He didn't try to be a Sadducee. He didn't try to be one of the homeboys that hanged around the Sea of Galilee. He didn't try to be just like them, but he was with them. But he acted in all things like his Father. Where was his Father? In heaven. So Jesus acted very heavenly while he was on the earth. And his disciples said, why are you going to do that? Why do you want to take time with those kids? Why do you want to do that? He says, because the kingdom of God is made up of those kids. Don't you know that? Where have you been? Nicodemus said, I don't understand all the stuff that you're saying. He says, that's because you're not born again. You mean I got to be born in my mother's womb again? You're a teacher of Israel. You're someone who's supposed to know better. And you don't understand the will of God from reading his book he gave you. He gave you 20-something books to read, and you still don't get it. Here I am to tell you, just like that serpent was raised up in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be raised up. And if I am raised up, I will draw all men to me. So it sounds like God wants some people that act a whole lot more like heaven, and they acted on earth. We don't do what it takes to get it done. We understand that heaven works on a different priority. The first thing we learn from this passage in verse number 5 is that heaven is clean. Heaven's clean. And you may not say, what do you mean clean? Look at verse 5. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, idolatry. That's not clean. That's not how heaven works. Heaven is pure. Heaven thinks rightly. Heaven doesn't cheat. Heaven doesn't cut corners. Heaven doesn't deal and get into the thick of sin and by sin to save sinners. Jesus came to sinners, but he brought salvation to those sinners. He was different. He was clean. He was so clean that even a leper could touch him, and the leprosy had to go. He was so clean that when the blind man came in contact with his clean fingers, the blindness had to go, and Jesus was untouched. When the prostitutes and the sinners touched him, He was so clean, the sin washed away, but Jesus remained unstained because he was on heaven's operation. I do things according to the Father's will, and I do it for heaven's will. That's a clean way. It's a pure way. The things of immorality, cheating on each other, wanting the things of this earth, wanting a little bit more of what I've already got, that's not of heaven. That's of here. And it derbies us. Because they worshipped idols back then too. They gave their crops. They gave their families. Sometimes they even gave their children to these idols. Jesus said, my church, you need to be clean of all that stuff. So you don't need to wonder, what's the next biggest building I can build? What's the next thing we can do for us? What's the thing we can do to gain more power and influence? Those things are of the earth, and they're unclean. They're trying to grab power that doesn't belong to us. Clean is, God, what do you want? What have you called me to do? Let me do it. No, it's not popular. When was it popular in the early church? Do you think people were cheating on one another in the early church? Do you think they didn't long for things they shouldn't be longing for? Do you think these were wonderful people? When Paul talks with Corinthians, he says, you were liars, you were cheats, you were homosexuals, you were adulterers, you were murderers, you were liars, but Jesus Christ cleans you all, and now you have been made into the church. So don't become those things again. Become who God has made you to be. Live the life he's given to you by Christ. Because it's a life not tied to earthly things or identities. It's tied to what has been done. I'm with Christ, so I don't do things of the earth because I want to do things that are heavenly. Second of all, heaven is a place of peace. If you look at verse 8 and 9, some people don't know how to live in peace. How do I know? Because they act in anger, they act in rage, they act in malice, they act in slander, and they act with filthy, degrading language to one another. I wonder if the internet would exist if people actually had to compliment each other constantly. Because I don't see that happening much. What I see is, I don't know you, so I'm going to call you scum of the earth. And I'm going to use every word, every colorful word I can use to do it. And if you think that hasn't translated into people's conversations, it has. We're less trusting. We're more on the defense. We're more guarded. We're more sheltered. Our fences get higher and our love diminishes. We're not a place of peace. Yeah, I know we're not at war, but we are. Not from foreign entities, but from our own hearts. You see, heaven, there is no war. In heaven, there is no, I've got to defend myself. In heaven, there is no, I've got to cover for myself. I have to be strong for me. I have to be strong for myself. I don't have to prove myself. I don't have to win in heaven because God has already won. There is no dissension. There is no difference. It is a place of peace. So I think if we're more heavenly, then the next place that ought to be a place of peace is a Christian home. So then there are no marital problems, right? There are no problems with kids being abused or with neighbors being told off. That's not things of peace. That's things of self. And I'm at war. I'm at war with the world. It's clear in the scriptures, you don't fight against flesh and blood, so stop it. You're fighting against principalities and powers that are warring on your mind and your heart, and you open the door and let them in and feel good about yourself for how strong you are. Heaven is a place of peace. There is no dissension. You don't have to be accepted. You're already accepted in the Beloved. So what is the favor of man? That's nothing. Jesus did not receive the favor of all men, did he? Some loved him. Some absolutely hated him. So did he shift? Did he change? Did he move with the wind? Because I'm trying to learn how he did it. But in the midst of a world just like ours, with Roman oppression putting its sandal on the neck of his own people, Jesus walked in peace. Jesus acted in peace. He didn't have to stress. He didn't have to worry. He didn't have to run, because when he walked with purpose. He didn't walk in any way other than peace. He was so peaceful, he got on the nerves of God's own people. Mary and Martha said, "Why are you so slow?" So all you slow people, hallelujah, Jesus is a slow person too. Hallelujah. All you people are late, yeah, I know it's a bad thing, but hallelujah, Jesus was late too. Because he was at peace. He knew exactly what his Father wanted to do. So while they acted in anger, while they acted in disappointment, and they took it out on Jesus, he could just say, "I am the resurrection and the life. Show me where the tomb is." See, my mouth gets ahead of me sometimes. How about you? I talk out of anger too much. What is, that's just my personality. Baloney. That's the things of the earth. He says, act like heaven. Act heavenly because you have been raised with Christ. So get that out of your life, whatever that thing is, and be at peace as heaven is. Heaven is also a place of compassion, if you see verse 14. He says he has wiped away all the requirements against us. Chapter 3, excuse me. It says that he has worked on our behalf to do something in our hearts. And this is what he said. Put on love. Let the peace of God rule your hearts. Be thankful. He says a little bit earlier, if you go up a little word, bear with one another in verse 13. Forgive one another. And as Christ forgave you, so also you must do that. What does that mean? I also titled that growth, because I'm going to tell you what. When you diminish people, when you ride people, when you belittle people, you're not growing them, you're shrinking. Do it to your kid. Do it to your grandkid. Tell them how bad they are and watch their spirit begin to close. And the church has been guilty of turning people against God because we refuse to forgive like He forgave us. Heaven is a place of compassion. And I know that, but I also learned, if we go to emphasis, I also learned that heaven is a place of judgment, which is 100% true. But he didn't say put on judgment. He didn't say put on a heavy-handed approach. He didn't say get a holy club in your hand and start beating the devil out of people. He says put on love. Put on compassion. Bear with one another. Oh, I can bear with one another. I can bear with anybody. Okay, you just told me you live by yourself. You just told on yourself. Because if you're living with anybody, you're going to know what it means to bear with one another. Doesn't matter. I can guarantee you that to be the case. I've lived with men in the dorm. I have lived with my wife for 20-something years now. I have lived in all kind of ways, and you have to bear with people, and people have to bear with you. But that is the call of God, because don't you want to see those around you grow? You want them to grow, let them know what forgiveness is. You see, our culture right now, and there's a lot of political problems I could point out. We don't forgive. You make a post 20 years ago, they will ruin your life. You say one thing they don't agree with, and I'm talking to the most powerful voices right now. You are forever defined by that moment. That is not love, no matter what they say. That is baloney and garbage on their parts. They can put love all over their car, but if they hate you because you love Christ, they are not loving. They are hateful. And if you return the favor, so will you. Because this is how earth works, but it's not how heaven works. Jesus hates sin, but he has compassion on us. And what is heaven's posture toward earth? I have come that they may have life. How does life come? Through forgiveness. Through bearing with one another. Through being at peace with one another. That's what God has given to us. And he puts that in light. I love, there's one thing that I did not share with you that it says about us in this chapter. It says, you are chosen, or the elect of God. Some of us probably have problems with this peace and this growth and this compassion and this cleanness because we've never been picked. We're always the last one. We're always the overlooked. We're always not the best of anything. We just kind of hung out in the middle. But Paul said, you are chosen. You have been picked out. You're not an accident. You're not a mistake. He didn't herd you in and mindlessly take you off. He chose you to be heavenly. What a great honor and what a great grace you have. With that power, we can close it out with 15 through 17. Heaven is also a place of joy. So you want to be heavenly in church and in your life? Then you're going to allow the Word of God to dwell in you richly. Teaching is not a burden. Teaching is a joy. What am I going to do a million years from now? You got an idea? I'm going to say, Lord, teach me more. Because I look at my world and I know nothing. I know not even a sliver of all that God has done. I want to know. I want to know. I want to know more. And he will teach me. And it's a place of joy. It's a place of full expression of life. He says, not only are you letting it dwell in you richly, you're teaching and you're admonishing one another, but you're admonishing them with songs. And you're happy about it. I mean, you're singing about it. You've got Elena spirit. You know what I'm talking about? Elena will start singing in a moment. I fussed her this moment because she got me some little teeny bopper song stuck in my head. I said, thanks a lot. Because she was just singing. Because she's just this little happy little sprightly little thing that's just singing because she's so happy inside. But then she convicted me when she started singing a Christian song. Right? I didn't ask her to. But she started singing. And the song was, amen. Blessing and honor and power and glory. Amen. And suddenly, I felt something else other than pride and other a little girl singing. I felt the Holy Ghost of God. Because heaven is not a place of dour faces. It's not a burden to bear. It's not a dragging yourself to the event. Heaven is a place of joy. Heaven is a place of excitement. Heaven is a place of celebration. When I look at Revelation, I don't even see him having seats. Because looking at him, I don't ever want to sit out again. If I need to recline, I'll recline on my face before him. Because all I want to do is worship. All I want to do is celebrate. All I want to do is magnify not even what he's done for me. I want to magnify how beautiful and how glorious and how wonderful he truly is. Heaven. Don't know a lot about it. But I know Jesus and God's at the center of it, and the angels are having a 24/7 party simply saying, holy, holy, holy. And it's a place of joy. When old Gabriel was told, I want you to go down to Nazareth. Yes, my Lord. It's not a burden, it's a joy. When the Holy Spirit came and visited us last week and he's coming here today, it's not, oh man, I got to go to the grumpy people in the 96. Oh my goodness, what am I going to do? He loves being here because heaven is a place of joy and he knows you by name. Right. Yeah. It's a place of joy. I have one more picture for you as we close. Please forget the cheesy pickup line. But I think it says something beyond that. Are you an angel? Because you're heavenly. That's cheesy. But if it works for you, happy. Go ahead. I'm trying to be full service here. But we've talked about other people like that. I've heard it said about one of the last ones we just lost, Jamie. She was just such an angel. Real angel? Wings and all? No. The way she acted reminded us not of earth, reminded us of heaven. She didn't start it. That's why we didn't say, oh, you act like such a Jamie. God's people ought to act like angels. But I honestly think we ought to act better than angels. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Angels are peering over heaven's gates just to see what's going on with those blackened, dark, evil as evil can be people that are now shining and shimmering in glorious beauty that is only matched by the beauty of Jesus Christ Himself. What in the world is going on with God's people today? They ought to see some purity. They ought to see some compassion. They ought to see love. They ought to see growth. They ought to see joy, because we have been raised with Christ. And we are seated with Him in the heavenly places. So my agenda is simply to act more like heaven. Would you stand? Oh, that sounds good, preacher, but we're in the real world here. Well, Jesus meant for you to live this way. And without the Holy Spirit, you could not. When Jesus taught us to pray, remember the words? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We ought to hallow His name. We ought to set His name apart from everything else. What's the first request? First request He taught us to pray. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Wait. On earth. Just that. Just period right there, right? No. As it is in heaven. So it sounds like, if I can paraphrase Jesus' prayer, pray that earth will get more heavenly. And you are the ones to pray for it. You are the ones to live it. You are the ones to bring it to earth. Can't do that. Yes, you can. And yes, you must. I would like our ushers to please come and take these elements, and as you can, set up several different places. So people come and get your own elements if you're able to partake today. You've accepted Jesus. A couple down the aisles, maybe a couple on the side, just let them pick their own communion, keep it as safe as possible. But I want you to join in. So if you've been passed by, raise your hand so you can grab one. Take it where you are with your family. That's okay. It's okay. I want us to pray while it's being passed out. It's okay. You keep your eyes open. God don't care. Doesn't bother you. But I want you to go ahead and prepare your hearts. Because when I pray, when I preach a sermon like this, I got to look to Brian's heart, not yours. I've just given you the truth. But what work I have to do is here. I can't change you. I can't do the Holy Spirit's work in you. I can just hand you the tools and say, let Him have His way. But here's where the work starts for me. I see too much of earth here. I see too much of earth here. I sometimes see too much of earth in my eyes, my ears, my hands. Does that mean I'm not good? See, well, I'm a good person. Heavenly. God says, I want you to be heavenly. Jesus is not good. He's perfect. He's not earthly. He's heaven. Just enough. And I have been given this right, not because I'm good, but because He's good. I don't know how this works, I just know it works. And I know that my mom just celebrated the birthday you have. What's that? No. 44. I'm fixing to turn 44. But I tell you that because I'm not who I was 44 years ago. I've seen a lot of ups and downs. I am changed. think if somebody's been in Christ all their life, they don't have much to change. Just look at me. That's a perfect testimony. Yes, there's still much to do. But I am different. I have been changed. So have you. You're not who you used to be. So it works. It's just, let's grasp it with everything. Let's take all of it. When she's praying for revival, she's not asking for anything other than let us be like heaven. That's it. Because hanging around this earth, we rub shoulders and we get diminished. It happens to us all. It's not something that's not understood by heaven. But that's why He sent the Holy Spirit to refresh us and renew us. So I'm going to be reminded of that even as we take communion today. So take off, turn it over, please. Miss Peggy does these. Thank you so much, Peggy. I love these things. Turn it over. Hope you didn't open your grape side yet. If you did, don't turn it over. You're on your own. But take your bread out. Yes, confession is important. I was reminded of that this week. Too little of our church, we have confession. We ought to pray that God will search our hearts, as David said, to know us. And if we've sinned, let's be the first to say, I'm sorry. Let's not be ashamed of it. Because we get ashamed of, I'm a Christian, I'm not supposed to do that. Hey, Jesus, if Jesus is working on you, don't be ashamed of His process. He's working on you. He's working on all of us. So let's, the pride's gone, we can all just get on with it and let Jesus do His work. When Jesus died, He said, this body is broken for you. For you, not fruit so your neighbor gets straightened out. It's for you. So when you take this, you do it in remembrance of Him. But now your life is His. It belongs to Him and it can be used by Him. So thinking on all those things, let's commit. Here's my life even as I celebrate you giving your life. So do this in remembrance of Him. Now please turn it over. Open up your juice. I love the part where Jesus shared that He took this cup and He passed it around. Some people would have been uncomfortable with that. Do you know what? I think we'd have got over it in Jesus' presence. If He's passing the cup, I want it. I'll put aside everything. I'll take it. Maybe this isn't the perfect representation of that, but it's a good one. This cup is for you. But as I look around, I see a whole lot of cups. Oh, the love of God. Oh, the power and the grace of God. I see older than me, younger than me, smarter than me. I won't say anybody's not as smart as me, but there's some elementary kids here, maybe. Maybe I am smarter than a fifth grader, but I don't know. But God loves us all. Leaving no one out. Oh, the love of God, and that we'll stand shoulder to shoulder. I wish we were more multicolored so we'd even see a greater diversity. Because heaven is good, like Kirk Franklin said one time. Connor, he said, we're going to look like a bunch of Skittles in heaven. So we're going to come from every background, every place, every way you can be. He's going to pull us out of everywhere. But all joined together by this blood that cleanses. Oh, thank you, Miss Beverly. She said it all. Not half, not three quarters, but every single solitary sin of mind, of heart, of mouth, of life, everyone covered and clean. So when He said, this is the new covenant, I drink and I drink with joy because by Jesus Christ, we are clean. Do it in remembrance of Him. Jesus, we praise Your name today and we celebrate the gift. Praise be to God. We celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is here because Jesus asked for Him to be here. The Holy Spirit is here because the Father sent Him. The Holy Spirit is here because He said, if you seek Me, you will find Me. The Holy Spirit is here because He said, where two or three are gathered together in My name, I am in the midst of wherever you are. So I celebrate the testimony of the presence of Jesus Christ in this place. The ritual is over, but the reality fills our hearts and fills the sanctuary with a renewed joy and vigor for life. God, everyone in this world is longing for something better. And dear God, I can commend all, saint and sinner alike, for longing for better. But God, the way they want better and the what of the better is where I must disagree. Because I believe the only way is for heaven to invade earth. And I believe for Your will to be done on earth, even as it's done in heaven, is the best thing that could ever happen to this planet. So Father, let it start in us. Let's not back up and be ashamed, and certainly not proud. Let's not dress in our own righteousness and say, I'm good enough. But oh God, let us humbly say, I want to be more like heaven. I want to be more like Jesus. And when people see me, I want them to see something different. And not a bad different. Not an ugly different. But I want a beauty so beautiful that it makes their heart ache, even if they don't have the courage to accept it. God, let beauty be seen in Your church, because You have done a beautiful thing in us. Thank You for Your word, and thank You for the truth of Your word. Oh God, go forth with Your people and breathe upon them today Your Holy Spirit, that Lord, as they leave, they may feel life. And through whatever they go through, that life may not overwhelm them and press them down and take away what You have granted them as an inheritance. But dear God, may they overcome those things and with joy say, I am His and He is mine. Blessed be the name of the Lord Jesus. Let the world see it and let them be amazed at the love, the goodness, the purity, the compassion, the joy that Jesus has brought to our hearts. We love You and thank You this day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Leave socially distanced as you can. But I pray that you are encouraged today, and I pray that you are an encouragement to people today. So wherever you go, look for that word, look for that act. Do it in Jesus' name. Let all God's people say, amen. God go with you.